Hey, welcome to another episode of Geek Bros Talk. I'm your host, and we're going to be going more, I think, longer lasting names. So, before every week, we need to have our own alias that was kind of related to geek culture. Trying to be brothers, right? So, we were like Ken and Ryu, we were like Michelangelo Donatello, etc., etc. But with the addition of our third host, I think we want to keep it, have our aliases be a little bit more permanent. That way it's kind of easier to recognize us from week to week. Also, we started running out of names, and that started getting hard.
There are only so many out
So,
there.
so many cool ones. We don't want to be like the lame brothers, I guess. Anyway, so I'm your host. Just call me Possibilities, or Pasta for short. And why don't you guys go ahead and introduce yourselves?
I'm Danny Boxcutter, or D-Box.
And I'm C64, also known as Commodore 64.
AKA old man, AKA grandpa.
That's right.
AKA still here.
Anyways, so with that introduction out of the way, basically with the addition of our new brother, who's going to be more of a regular on our show, why don't you guys probably know our personalities a little bit, what we're into, what we like geeking out about. So with him, since he's new to the show, why don't we go ahead and start off with what you're into and what you like, and what you're a geek about, and maybe what is a geek to you.
All right, cool. So first of all, I just want to say I'm really happy to be on this channel doing this kind of thing. It's really cool to just geek out with my brothers. I mean, growing up, that's what we did, and it's nice to be able to continue doing it even though we're all over the place. So me myself, I'm also over here in Cali. I run a bar over in the East Bay, and I spend a lot of my time doing stuff with food and drink. And I mean, this area too, there's so many shows, so I always try to go catch anything new that comes up, be it like, new music or whatever else is coming up. It's normally what I'm jamming out on.
Cool. So, I mean, with that out of the way, is there anything exciting? Well, let me step back for a second. So my second question was, what is a geek to you? Since this is like a geek-oriented channel, I know you're a huge geek. I mean, you're my brother, so I know that. But what makes you a geek? What do you like? What is the culture about to you?
Well, I feel like nowadays the term geek is being reappropriated. It used to be kind of like it was kind of a stigma back in the day. But I mean, you're geeking out about something that just shows how into it you are, no matter what people think. Like, that's what you want to do with your time, that's what you want to be all up into, and that's like real passion, drive, and commitment for whatever it is. Like I said
Definitely.
earlier, I spend a lot of my time with beer, and so I go to breweries, I go to events and competitions, and like I homebrew myself too. And even now, more and more of my house is being taken up with beer equipment, and I'm running out of space.
Yeah, all that beer and beer accessories, pretty much. And I'm sure it's exciting for you because the industry is like exploding at the moment, right? So you're kind of
Oh,
a part of
yeah.
that movement, you know?
Now is one of the best times for beer because the market is everywhere. You look around, craft brew, it's on the scene. That's what's cool. And on top of that, they're actually making inroads. They're actually staying in this industry. It's not just Budweiser, Busch, or Coors anymore. Like, there are new up-and-coming beers that people are paying attention to, and they're not going anywhere.
Yeah, and that's definitely a recurring theme on our channel, is being on the edge of new stuff coming out. Technology is always moving, beer is always moving now. Even with the food industry, I mean, we kind of see like a amalgamation of both, like the food and tech and beer all coming together. So I mean, I think it's like a great place to be in right now. And not
Oh,
only do
yeah.
you share like the love for beer and food industry and things like that, but you also love gaming, other just like, more
Oh, yeah.
traditional geek culture.
We were just playing last week, and we've got more games to play soon.
Yeah, I mean, she guys, since your episode last week, we've been doing like these Let's Play with the three of us now, which is really fun. We're lifelong gamers, and it's always going to be like that. So that's never going to go away. But you also like other things like board games,
Oh,
right?
yeah. I was playing some last night, and the other thing, too, is like I've got a shelf that's just starting to overflow with board games, and it's, you know,
so what are some of the board games that you enjoy for people like myself who are not familiar with the board games that people are playing now?
Mm-hmm. So even before we get into that, so what board games are you familiar with? What is like the last board game you can remember playing?
The last board game, yeah, Monopoly. That was the last one. Monopoly. And
all right. It's pretty vanilla.
Yeah, and then when I was in middle school, maybe junior high, I think I played a little bit of D&D, but it was so little that I can't remember.
Can we talk about D&D again later? Because there's some new stuff that came out that I'm really stoked about.
Yeah, of course. But
so that's the extent of my board game experience.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. So before we get on an offshoot, so what board games were you playing the other night?
So we played Roll For It, which is this really fast-paced, quick game. And it's good for, you know, people who haven't been playing a lot of new board games. Mm-hmm. It's really simple in how it's set up. It reminds me of Yahtzee because it's all dice rolling. Mm-hmm. And everyone gets 6 dice, right? Mm-hmm. And they're all D6s, so 1 through 6. Right. And there's a deck, right? Each deck will have a certain combination of dice shown there. So it'll be like 4 fours or, you know, like, oh, here's a 1, 2, 3, and 4, right?
So especially when you're rolling something, it's correlating to some card, right? But it has to be kind of like the exact...
Right. Roll, right. So yeah. You go around and after you determine your starting order, each person takes turns rolling their set of dice. Mm-hmm. If they happen to have something that matches up with what's on the board at the moment, they get to take that card, and each card has a certain point value. Mm-hmm. So the goal is to get to 40 points. Right?
So it's just like all based on luck? I mean, this is what it seems like at this point.
At this point, it is a lot of random based dice rolling.
Right.
But where the strategy comes in is odds are you're not always going to have something to fill out that card, right? Mm-hmm. So what you can do is you can take some of your dice that correspond to those numbers and you could leave it at one of those cards in the hopes that next time you roll, the remaining dice will help add up to that number.
So you're saying you re-roll one dice only, right? So you keep one die and then you re-roll
the other one? So, like, let's, you reroll however many you have that aren't attached to that card.
Oh, okay.
So, like, if a card has, like, oh, I'm trying to get 6 sixes, and you happen to roll 2 sixes that turn, you can roll, you can leave your 2 sixes there and try to roll the 4 for the next time.
Okay.
So, you're kind of taking a chance that you might get better. So, the first person to get to 40 wins?
Yes. And more elements of strategy come in because, yeah, that might seem it's worth a lot of points, but it's not that easy to get. And you're stuck rolling for that one until you get it. Whereas you can kind of divide your dice out among some of the smaller sets and kind of build up points that way.
Yeah, this sounds like a statistician's dream. This is just
probability. Yeah, exactly.
What is the most likely random or like likelihood to roll?
If you are you're a math nerd and you're watching this is the game for you.
You could probably, I mean, of course, you can always increase your chances to win, but you can reliably increase your chance to win. Even like Monopoly, right? There are some strategies that are proven like mathematically, you know, like just the likelihood for you to get more money off whichever properties. Like I heard Boardwalk is like a terrible choice.
Oh yeah.
Statistically speaking. But, you know, sometimes statistics don't always work. But, I mean, you know, for the most part, you can increase your odds. Anyways.
Exactly. And then sometimes you're dissuaded by your lust and your greed. And you're like, no, I can do this.
Yeah.
Monopoly is one of the best inventions ever made. You know, it's still applicable today.
till you get beat by your significant other's little cousins who are 10 years old. And then you feel like a failure at life. You just want to flip the board over. Not that it's happened to me personally or anything, but
yeah.
Board flipping in Monopoly is very real.
Yeah, board flipping on a 10-year-old, that's not, that's probably not a healthy thing.
I mean, you know, say what you will, these games are fun. You know, it's like the Mario Party syndrome, right? Or the Mario Kart syndrome, even. It's like, yeah, you're friends when you start, but after you're done playing, it's a good chance that you're not.
Yeah. One of these days, I would love to do a long playthrough of Dokapon Kingdom, because that game is Mario Party meets Monopoly with a persistent RPG world, which sounds awesome. until 12 hours later, no one on the couch is talking to each other, and everyone's just staring each other down.
Oh, this sounds crazy.
It has all the elements of, I don't know, like, just a... The board game, like the feeling of playing a board game, like, all right, everyone starts off at the neutral point and then you're trying to get ahead, right? But It also has the element of other people trying to screw you over, and then the other element of RNG, or randomly generated numbers, screwing you over as well. And so it starts out really fun, but then you run into people screwing you over, and then a game screwing you over, and then you're like, why am I even playing this?
But you can't stop for some reason. You're like, no, yeah. I can come back.
There's always a chance. Yeah. Like, all right. I'm 20 levels behind, but you know, if I roll this right one, maybe I'll only be 15 levels behind.
So that's very akin to really good game design. For example, you played Ninja Gaiden on the Nintendo 8-bit. Mm-hmm. That game was so hard. You kept dying so much. You loved abuse. You kept wanting to keep playing.
But the difficulty is calculated in that one, right? So if you're dying, it's your own fault. Yeah, there's like a very slim, narrow margin for you to succeed. But if you master it, you should be able to, in theory, right? To be able
with
to just
all the, it. But games like this is so random,
right?
Because you're taking into account other players and their, you know,
yeah,
that's very unpredictable. And then just
exponentially
with
RNG on top of that. So
no, but what I'm saying is the actual design of the game, it makes you want to keep playing. So whatever the hook is, in the case of Ninja Gaiden, it was pure difficulty. In the case of the game you're talking about here, you want to keep playing.
Even though, of course,
dude, I should stop before I like do something bad.
It's a hook for a very different reason.
It's a hook because you want to grind your friends into the ground. Be like, oh, hey, you stole my town. I'm going to track you down and rob you.
Yeah, it's a competitive gamble. That's why.
I didn't ask this, but is this a board game or is it a video game?
It's a both. Video game that's pretty much a board game.
Yeah.
Oh.
So,
is that a Steam?
You're still moving around the world. Instead of dice, you have a little spinner, which will determine how many spaces you can move.
Essentially Mario Party, but as an RPG. So
is
if you ever play
Steam?
Mario Party.
Is that on Steam or?
It's on GameCube and Wii. So
Yeah. Okay.
I think it came Yeah.
It might have come out on some, maybe PS2, I think. Maybe some other systems, but. I don't know. Maybe there's a good chance we can get it like on an emulator or something and play it out online. It's actually
I don't ever remember that game. That's the weird thing.
It was kind of it's more of a Japanese centric game.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
it's fun, but it's not. And I've left sessions where everyone left, no one said a word except for, all right, I'll see you next week.
Yeah. So I mean. If you guys thought Mario Kart and Mario Party was bad, which they are in their own respect, but at least Mario Kart, it is based on skill as well. So there's an element of getting a random item. It's like, oh, I got blue shell at the very end. That still sucks. But at least you can use your actual kart skills to get ahead. And Donkey Kong Kingdom is just your friends and an RNG, and you don't know why you play it, but you keep playing it.
And then the random nature of it is, it kind of never gets boring because it's always a different game.
And that is part of it too, because it's always fresh, and in the back of your mind, you're like, oh, okay.
There's always a chance.
There's always, hope springs eternal in these games.
Yeah, but then you can go maybe like 10 turns and you're still at the bottom of the totem pole. So.
Well, also speaking of other board games, makes me think of whenever you were playing Risk Legacy with us. That game, you want to talk about more hating people and random chance.
So for people who don't know, the Legacy series of board games, they take a new twist on classic board games. You know, Risk has been around forever. There are a few other Legacy games as well, right? I can't think of them off the top of my head.
But in
Risk Legacy, so you take the concept of regular Risk, but you every time you play through it, you permanently modify the board. As in, you're putting stickers on there, regions change, and things like that. Like,
oh wow!
You get a name continents if you win.
You get like the continents because they have different modifiers, right? So it adds like another level of depth. It's when you play the next time, it's never vanilla Risk. It's slightly changed, and the more you play it, it kind of mimics like the real world, I guess. Like if you were in a real war, it's like lands will get scarred, and like you know, some lands will become unusable or worthless because of the war. The last playthrough.
Yeah.
Like some places get nuked out, some places have like better bunkers and things like that.
And so it's always changing, it's always adapting.
Yeah.
And it's really great if you have like a dedicated group of friends, because you even have like basically you have board game DLC. There are certain boxes you can only open after you've met certain conditions.
Oh, that's crazy.
And it's cool because the game will continue for about 10 victories. And whoever has the most victories, because you sign your name on the board every time.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever has the most victories at the end of it, the world becomes theirs.
Oh, wow. And also because it is unique to the people playing it, that
mm-hmm.
world is only for them.
Oh, yeah. Like, we've
yeah.
named our countries and continents ridiculous things.
Yeah. I remember one, like, South America is Taco Town.
Yep.
it's also like, and you actually write the names on the actual board.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really cool.
And then
it really
you're stuck with it, too, because you're like, oh, why didn't you see
that? Yeah. And, yeah, it's really fun because it just increases the longevity of the board game. And it's a different playthrough every single time. It's still Risk, but it is different every time you play it. So it makes you want
to
keep playing it.
I remember playing Risk. That was
another
one
yeah.
I played. Yeah.
Well, and the good thing about this one is it also gives you different win conditions. So that way you're not stuck. It's not going to be a 10-hour game every time. You don't have to completely dominate the world. There are certain conditions that pop up. And if you can fulfill them, you can just win. Which is what happened in one game where Pasta here played for what 2 hours, and you
yeah.
Guys
so we had one of our other friends over, and I think it was his first time playing this version of Risk. So he was asking a ton of questions, and everyone's making their strategical moves right, because you got to think two or three steps ahead in Risk. And so unfortunately, I think just the way I placed my troops, it took about 2 hours for two turns, and I lost in two turns.
It was. Awful.
Yeah.
Because there was a mission card that came up, and whoever could finish that action, I think it was like taking over a certain country and holding it for so long.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, are you kidding me?
Anyways, yeah, I got shafted. I went like, I had maybe 15 minutes of playtime, if that, and it took 2 hours to get there. But, you know, these masterminds over here, they're plotting their. You know, they're like 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th step in advance, and then turns out, oh man, I can't do anything now. So I guess it art imitates life, and I guess that's how it is in the real world sometimes.
So that's so funny to see y'all talking about
yeah.
physical board games. You know, a lot of people, unless you're actually in that community,
mm-hmm.
you would think that that thing is extinct. You know, but yeah, it's a thriving community. There's premium
yeah.
board games as well. If I understand.
Yeah,
yeah,
definitely. And I think it's just a trend in maybe our generation too. I did see an article where they're saying this generation prefers physical books as opposed to ebooks. And
mm-hmm.
the pace that I think physical books are starting to kind of like outpace ebooks at this point.
Right. It's a lot of media that people thought were gone. Like vinyl sales in England
have
actually topped in over a decade. It's like they beat out all other forms of music
mm-hmm.
media.
Yeah, and that's why companies like Amazon, you know, they open up the Amazon bookstore in Washington, in Seattle. And they're going to be opening up more places like that. So that's kind of weird, you know. But at the same time, you know, if you look throughout history, things that were old become new again, the whole retro thing. So it's kind of funny.
Cyclical.
Yeah, but especially if you are, like for yourselves, you're old enough to have witnessed a VHS tape to the first
oh,
game systems,
right.
you know, you've been through
yeah.
the whole range. So that's kind of weird
mm-hmm.
when you see that, like, younger kids, younger than you, are like, oh, man, that's retro. That's old, you know? So
I mean, at this point, I don't really see CDs or USB sticks coming back.
No.
Just because of, like, the way, like, the digital stuff works, right?
Mm-hmm.
I can see why, like, you know, physical books and vinyls are coming back, just because it's not just a nostalgia thing, but it's different enough in our world, you know, to have something that's not digital, right? Something we actually hold. And that is something that is kind of missing.
Mm-hmm.
So,
it's concrete. It, like, it's in your hands, and there's that physical connection with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so as someone, like, I collect vinyls. They're,
mm-hmm.
sometimes I ask myself why, because they're costly and they take up space.
Mm-hmm.
But there's something about it I really enjoy. And it's... the music still sounds great. The quality is fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
It's still hard to match. Like, dot flacks
mm-hmm.
are one of the only like few newer media
which for you guys who don't know stands for fully lossless audio.
Yeah, so no loss in quality.
Yeah.
Which results in like huge sizes for those files, which mm-hmm. doesn't make it quite as, you know, convenient or applicable in certain situations. But mm-hmm. it's like the quality is still fantastic on vinyl. And what I'm starting to relearn is I'm listening to albums from start to finish.
Mm-hmm.
Because in an age where we can piecemeal everything with Spotify or Pandora or just like look up a song on YouTube,
attention spans are much shorter now. And
exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I was like, okay, most albums, it's like, all right, a couple songs here are good, I like, and that's it.
Mm.
Whereas I'm going back to a lot of these older produced albums, and like they're designed that way on purpose. From start to finish, that track listing takes you through a certain journey that they intended you to experience.
It's a pretty meta thing in music, I would say, because like, it's a lot harder to track, right? Just get tracks on vinyl.
Yeah.
But yeah, and maybe like we're just conditioned to interact with an electronic in such a way where, oh, if I'm not getting anything out of it within the first 5 seconds, I gotta try something else, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, and that's a good thing, I think, because I myself, you know, as y'all know, I'm a huge book lover. I've been a book lover my whole life, and that's the whole physicality of it's one thing. But the other thing is, like, similar to vinyl, it is a journey as you are reading it. You know, you're very focused on it, and your mind is able to really be absorbed in this whole world, whether it be music or literature or whatever. Whereas when it's, like, available like that, your mind is not really fully, focused on it. And then you really, I just really feel like the experience is not the same. Mm-hmm. It just simply isn't, you know? Like, if
you
I listen
have a lot
to...
of distractions.
A lot of distractions, and at the same time, you know, very similar to the whole vinyl thing, you know, as you're listening to a whole vinyl, you actually get lost in it, in my opinion, you know, whereas if I'm listening to digital, I don't even pay attention a lot of times. It's just like background noise.
It's filler. Whereas you're actually, you're willingly devoting your time and all of your senses, and there's this heightened level of focus. And through it, you can pick up on more and you gain a greater sense of appreciation for what it is.
And also mentally, when you have to physically take action and do something, your mind automatically becomes more focused. Like the physicalness of turning pages, the physicalness of putting the needle on the record, all those things actually start to produce action in your mind. And so it's all related. And I hope more and more of the younger generation get into the physical stuff, you know, it's really great stuff.
The only thing is, you know, these big companies and corporations, they know that younger people are starting to pick up in popularity. So, you know, with that, they can price it, you know, with what they want it to.
And they do. And they do, right? If you collect vinyl, it could be very expensive.
The prices are going up and they're profiting off of us. I mean, it's a trend, but they're making money off the trend. So,
yeah.
But at the same time, we're seeing like really cool things in vinyl too. Like there are so many new colorations and prints and stuff. Let me grab one real quick that I really think is awesome.
Yeah, for sure.
And you know, another thing that I remember about vinyl, I used to have an old Techniques turntable. You know. What about turntables? Yeah, sure. Are they selling more as well because of the vinyl?
Yeah. People are starting to come up.
So, yeah.
People just like the physical aspect to it, you know? It's there, they have it, and there's a sense of nostalgia, which is cool right now, so that helps heighten it.
So what vinyl do you have?
So this is the Doomstar Requiem. So we'll talk about geeking out. This is Metalocalypse's fourth album.
Sweet.
And what started out as a comedy metal band on Adult Swim has actually resulted in four fantastic albums that really play homage to all things metal. Like, everything is solid. Brendan Small, he knows what he's doing whenever he like picks apart these different genres, and he's making certain nods to like one subset of metal, or whatever. He's like, yeah.
It's a really well done satire and deconstruction of the metal community. Yeah. But not only is it spot on, it's actually really, really well done. You know?
Yeah, it's really good music. That's what I've heard. Yeah. Like, they're actually really great
and
musicians. Jokes
and animation. Like, the metal albums in general is just, like, really well done all around.
It's hilarious. If you haven't watched it, I recommend checking it out. And so the cool thing is, so the Doomstar Requiem, this is basically their magnum opus for it. There are no plans to retouch it at the moment, but they were able to end with a fully a fully done rock opera.
Sweet.
And first of all, just look how cool that is. Look at that vinyl.
Oh, that's awesome. That reminds me so much of the original vinyls, especially in the 80s, heavy metal. I remember AC/DC, Quiet Riot, Wasp. You know, that always reminds me of those vinyls.
Yeah, you know? It's just like, it's all over the top, and like, I love this kind of work, because most people think vinyls, and it's just like, oh, it's all like the matte black and everything. But I've got actually quite a colorful collection. Like, literally, I've got translucent red, there's like this amazing glossy pearl, and all kinds of other cool designs on this too. And that's something else you can only get through, you know, physical media with it. This album covers and artwork, people put so much time into it. Which isn't to say, like, they aren't putting it for, like, whenever they're distributing CDs and posters and other music, but I just love how everything comes together here.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel like it's kind of one of those half-half things, where half of it is fueled by, like, the passion, the other half is fueled by the monetary gain from it. But for the most part, it allows us to have both, right? So for the people who really love it out there, it's there. And for the people who make money off it, it's also there. So
I'm just waiting for, like, cartridges to come back with actual instruction books, you know, with the big, big booklets with art format. I mean, if you look at the Zelda Breath of the Wild box, it's just a case and the micro SD card. That's all you get. I'm like, whatever happened to beautiful box art, beautiful
booklets? Do you see the Binding of Isaac physical copy for Switch?
Yes.
It comes with, like, an old school NES instruction booklet. It looks like straight from the 80s.
I don't know if you've seen that.
And because we were playing, if we had signed up on Kickstarter for the River City Ransom Underground, you could have gotten an old box and a cartridge with everything.
Oh, man.
And it's like, you know, you're right. Nowadays, people are like, all right, here's a brief manual that's like two sides. And it's like, oh, come on.
That's even if you get a manual.
I love reading through things. I love artwork. I would love it whenever they would have, like, comics that would help, you know, enrich in the world. I was like,
yeah, I miss that. I mean, they took a lot of care into it. I mean, I wish I still kept all my old games, because I really did read through the manuals. I enjoyed the artwork. And I understand you could buy these collector's box with all this stuff, but it's not the same. You know, I had all the different game systems. I mean, I could tell, like, when I was watching it, looking at a 3D old box cover, the difference between that and a Jaguar box and a Nintendo box. Mm-hmm. My favorites were the Nintendo. They were my favorites because they had the most care in them. So.
Yeah. I like the original PSX cases, like the big old plastic glass jewel cases.
Yeah.
Like the really tall ones, you know? Oh, man. I see those in, like, an old game store. I just get real nostalgic about it.
I know.
I think mostly just, like, I think when I was a kid and, like, you know, we didn't have PlayStation back then because we had, like, Nintendo 64. But I'd look at it and, like, oh, look at all these games and, like, I don't know, there'd be, like, some scary-looking game or something. I'd just be fascinated with it, but, you know, it's, like, the fact that you didn't own it or the system. It's just, like, you always would go
there. You're like, oh, I want it.
It's,
I want it.
Like, intriguing, right? And you'd have the internet to look it up or see what it was about. You just saw the box cover, you saw the back, and you just wonder what kind of game it was.
Yeah,
exactly.
And so both of my brothers, they're old enough to remember the times before the internet where you would have to look at a game magazine and just get excited over it. And then you saw the box art. You didn't know what the game was about, whether or not it was good or not. It just looked cool. So if you saw cool box art, you probably wanted the game just because the box cover looked cool.
Or even if she didn't want it, I mean, you're just intrigued. And it's kind of one of those things, like, every time you go back to the game store, you always look at it just because, like, I don't know, man.
So speaking of that, which was one of y'all's favorite box covers? I know there's been so many games, but one that just comes to mind for y'all.
One that stands out to me, GoldenEye on the original N64.
Oh, that's pretty legit.
That was a classic one, and I think the reason why it stands out to me is because like the way James Bond is holding his gun is kind of like towards his face, and I always saw it in this weird angle where like he had like a blown up cheek, just like his hand was part of his cheek, and he just had like this really like wide face, and then it's like an optical illusion for me. So every time I look at that box art cover, that's what I see. But then at the same time, like, oh, it's actually just his hand holding a gun, and that's why it stands up to me. So.
I would say I loved all the old Castlevania ones because all the illustration and artwork. A lot of other video games, you know, at the time, they went for, you know, cute graphics and things like that, like bright colors.
I mean, TPO, I mean, it's like the era of like mascot platformers almost.
Yeah.
Right, so
it's like there, you couldn't throw a rock without hitting some kind of bipedal furry character that's like, I'm going to run through the stage and collect whatever item. Whereas like Castlevania, that was like,
it was real, man. It was like,
yeah, it reminded me of like Boris Vallejo stuff. It's like it's all over the top and like lovingly illustrated.
But it was anime inspired though, so that's what was awesome about it.
Kind of like there was a certain trend that came afterwards, because like you could chart the progression starting, and the most anime Castlevania has gotten was during the
The PlayStation era, whatever.
No, even past that. It was Game Boy Advance and DS.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because Aria of Sorrow and Dawn of Sorrow.
Yeah, those that's on like, DS, right? Yeah.
Yeah, those got super anime. But you look back at, you know,
Symphony of Night, I mean, it's one that sent out
That artwork fantastic. Because what was that? Was it Yoshitaka Amano that was doing it?
Or I think so. Yeah. Yeah. She was the composer.
Michiru Yamane
Michiru
was the composer.
Okay.
No, sorry. Yoshitaka Amano, he did the work for like the Final Fantasy before Tetsuya Nomura took over and for Vampire Hunter D.
Yeah, I love Vampire Hunter D.
But it's that same like really gothic art style, which I was like, ah, this is really cool. What about you, Tui?
For me, it was the Final Fantasy 2. I don't know what it was. The very first Final Fantasy, and then even a Final Fantasy 2. It was just so simple, you know. But I don't know what it is. For me, when I saw it, I got really excited. I got really emotional. So anytime that I saw the Final Fantasy font.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. That's just me. That one, and I would tie it with the Zelda, the original Nintendo cover. I just love that. It's
classic.
It's classic.
Like golden cartridge.
Oh man, I actually have one of those, and I played through it recently, and those games still hold up.
It's still fun.
Yeah,
it's like I honestly feel like I like the top down Zeldas more than I like the 3D ones. Yeah.
I mean, we haven't played Breath of the Wild yet, so we can't say.
I know. So far.
Still waiting for that, but...
Although I will say, I played Link to the Past and Link Between Worlds again, and man, those games are fun.
Yeah, I mean, even Oracle Seasons, Oracle Ages was really good, too. I mean, I remember just having a blast with those. Yeah. Anyways, how do we get on this topic, video game art covers? the idea of physical media and what is kind of so special about it. I recently bought, So I got this sweet GameCube keyboard controller. So this was meant for Phantasy Star Online, which was like a online RPG. It wasn't an MMORPG necessarily, but it was an online RPG.
It still has so much grinding.
It was the first one. It was the first one on a major system.
So it originally came out on Dreamcast, and it's kind of like the era where online play was starting to become a thing. Technically online gameplay was available from like the Sega Saturn, even Nintendo 64 in Japan at one point. But I feel like the Dreamcast was like the first one to really kind of do it kind of mainstream almost, right?
Yeah.
So they had keyboard controllers. Yeah, it was ahead of its time. It had keyboard controllers and whatnot. So I got a GameCube one, and this is specifically for Phantasy Star Online. And I guess what I was trying to get at is the seller I bought it from also included some cool little physical cards for Phantasy Star Online Episode 3, which was like a card game.
Sweet.
I got these sweet, like, you know, trading cards, and yeah, it's just really cool, really nice to have. And
that's
like,
real cool.
I mean, as a geek, it's like, man.
And those are the Japanese, like, playing cards, though.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
sweet.
And,
it's like any kind of cool collectible stuff that they give you without you having to pay for it. Be like, no, right. They're like, thank you, take some
and
of
it,
this.
And it really has no value to anyone else, but to other geeks. But I don't know, it just makes you happy just to have it, you know. So I can appreciate that. And it kind of goes back to a thing where it's worth what you want to pay for it, right?
Mm-hmm.
What is it worth to you? There's like that Rick and Morty quote, right, where I think Jerry was collecting coins or something, and like the alternative universe Rick was like, it's what's worth to you, Jerry. That's what matters. Anyway, so yeah, this controller is eventually going to get a mechanical keyboard modded into it. So I'm going to just replace this out, throw a 40% keyboard in there, because you guys know I love mechanical keyboards. I have like 5 of them. And so this is going to be a birthday gift from my friend who loves playing Smash and League of Legends. And so I figured, yeah, you know,
both.
Have a controller that can
both.
Do you both. Yeah. So, yeah, I think that was just...
That is so cool. And, you know, I just remembered something. The Sega Master System was really the first device to actually have an internet capability back in the 80s.
Yeah.
But that was a Japan-only thing. That was kind of weird.
The Mega Drive or...
No, 32? The Sega Master System.
Master System. Oh,
yes,
yeah,
it's so weird. It had some weird adapter that was only available in Japan. It's kind of weird that they had, and it wasn't truly internet, but
you could download games, right? If I remember correctly, it had some service where you could download
mm-hmm.
games to your cartridge.
That's right.
Or like,
that's right.
Like you subscribed, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I kind of miss all of those crazy old peripherals.
Yeah.
Speaking of everything that's physical, because you know nowadays, like everything you can just like capture with your camera and everything. Which is cool, but whenever you had the Dreamcast, you had like the full getup. You had like, oh, here are all of our collection of light guns,
mm-hmm.
fishing controller.
I love the Dreamcast.
Some of the Amigo maracas.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like,
man.
Oh.
I wish I would have kept it. I missed my Dreamcast. It's just, I don't even know what happened to it.
Yeah,
I know where it
gave
is.
It to us.
Oh.
It's in Arkansas.
Yeah,
oh,
you gave it to us.
Oh, so that's my original?
Yeah, that's the one he gave us. And
oh, okay. It still works?
Yeah.
Oh,
kind of
okay.
Back,
it's like,
there's
what happened to it?
Games on it?
Okay, great. At least y'all still have it. It's like,
I mean, no, it's gone.
Yeah, I thought I sold it. Okay.
No. We have it.
Awesome.
I want to let you know, we put that thing through its paces. Like, we used it so much.
Yeah.
I mean, part of it was the fact that it was so easy to... download games and play them on them. Yeah. Play backup copies of games we legally owned on it. You know.
Legally owned.
Yes. And yeah, it was just an amazing system. Not just for that. I mean, for that, but there are just a lot of great games out there. And,
it was.
You know, as a kid with not that much, you know, financial income, being a kid and whatnot, it was a great way to explore just a ton of different game genres and game types to see, like, play stuff that you probably normally wouldn't even play, because you can download Japanese games on it, like played Shenmue 2 on it, which never came to the US, which was like a blessing to us. But yeah, that thing was crazy. And just
crap out of some virtual tennis.
Yeah.
I mean, the reason why I love the Dreamcast so much is because it was the first console that I can remember that was arcade perfect. And if you loved arcade games, I mean, the first time I bought it,
everything
and
up to that point,
oh, it's amazing.
We're never up to par with the actual arcade cabinets.
Yes.
I mean, even back to, you know, NES, the Genesis. I mean,
mm-hmm.
especially like it's apparent in like the Genesis Super Nintendo era, especially.
Yep.
I mean, I guess you could argue that Neo Geo technically was arcade perfect too.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. But not everybody can afford it.
But yeah, no one could afford that. So.
I mean, the first time I played Soul Calibur on it, I was just like, oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm glad y'all still have it.
Yeah, it still works. I do miss the VMUs, too. They always found so many cool ways to, like, incorporate that into games and stuff. I was like, oh, that's
interesting. It really was ahead of its time.
Yeah, you got to give it to Sega. They were really pushing a lot of things that just was like years ahead of anybody who's able to do it. And that's kind of crazy.
And for those of you who don't know, VMU stood for a virtual memory unit. And it was a memory card. Visual? What's
it? Yeah. Okay. It has a screen on it. It's an LCD screen on it.
And it was a memory card, but it had like a full little D-pad and like a couple of buttons, and you could play games on it.
Yeah, you could play some mini games. Others. Yeah.
I mean, you guys remember like Tamagotchis, like those old kind of keychain LCDs? Yeah. That's what it pretty much was. But it also stored your save games on there. It would also act as like a display on your controller, and then you could also plug two in together, so you could like have a little mini battle with someone.
Chow battling.
And I'm so glad that y'all still have it. I was just like, I might need to take it back.
Some other crazy peripherals, you know, from like that kind of era. N64 had a few. I remember like Hey You Pikachu with the microphone and the voice recognition. I know Dreamcast had that too with C-Man.
Yeah.
That was a weird game.
That was a weird game. That was a weird one. Leonard Nimoy, rest in peace.
Yeah.
And then I had the Pokemon Stadium.
Yes. That you could attach your Game Boy to it, yeah. I mean, but to be fair, Super Nintendo had that too. The Super Game Boy, right?
Super Game Boy. And, I mean, come on. Their light gun, they give you a bazooka. The Super Scope.
Yeah, the Super Scope.
Super Scope was sick.
Or the Nintendo pad. That was...
For track and field?
Yeah.
God, that was a precursor horrible. To DDR pads.
Yeah,
the DDR pads were so much better.
Yeah.
But they had that.
We also had keyboard and mouse for Super Nintendo for Mario Paint.
Those stupid flies.
Yeah. Swat the flies. Anyways, I mean, we still get, I guess, like the Wii. I mean, we got a ton of peripherals too, right? We got all sorts of accessories for the Wiimote. Balance boards, light guns, sword handles, I mean, what have you. But yeah, I mean, it's definitely a different era now. I mean, now we're trying to like have as little stuff as possible. We're trying to have one device be, you know, multi-purpose for everything rather than having a bunch of small pieces of plastic. I mean,
and I've got a PS4 right now, and my physical collection is almost non-existent because I was like, oh yeah, I could either go somewhere, buy the box and bring it home, or I can just from my couch, I'm like, I'll just download this.
Yeah, but you still have to download updates and stuff, though. I mean, you know, so it's not the full, complete game like back then. You bought the physical game and that's it. That was the whole game. Yeah,
that's another different thing, too, between people like, oh, here's a pre-planned DLC before the game even comes out, you know. Whereas back then, you didn't have the option to patch games. It's like, all right, no, that's it. Good luck.
Not unless you had a Game Genie, you could kind of modify it by cheating, but
oh man, between Game Genie and Game Shark and all that,
anyways, we've kind of derived from our original conversation. Anyway, so you know, the other point we're supposed to kind of really talk about is some of the other stuff other than video games, because we love talking about video games and it's pretty apparent,
as you can tell.
Yeah, it's pretty, you just get lost into that rabbit hole. But yeah, so you mentioned that you're also kind of into the beer scene as well. And I know that there were some pretty big events recently because it was Beer Week.
There were two beer weeks.
Yeah, there were two beer weeks. So, I mean, why don't we just talk about that a little bit and kind of like the state of beer today and like I guess how it was a few years ago even, right? Like just the progression and the growth of the beer industry.
All right, so as a heads up, I'm also in the Bay Area, which is a fantastic place to be in the beer scene because everything is exploding. All right, so in February we kicked off SF Beer Week, and that is one of the biggest beer events in the Bay, because for that 1 week, every brewery, every bar that does craft beer, they're pulling out all the stops. And like the bar that I run, we had a few big events as well, and that's just something everyone gravitates towards at this point. Last year there were over 1,000 beer events.
Wow.
In a span of 1 week. So do the math on that.
And you're like, are you kidding? No one has time for that. But that just goes to show the appeal and draw of it right now. Like, everyone wants in on it. And because of that, we're lucky because it, so like, there are always new breweries opening up, but in order to stay relevant and to succeed, they either have to be better or stand out from the rest of the competition, right? Same as any other new business.
So what, I mean, for somebody who's really not into, well, basically for somebody who's beyond a mainstream beer drinker, where Bud Light is, you know, Bud Light, Budweiser, Coors is, you know what I'm saying, that's the mainstay. What separates that from this growing community? Like, what's considered a quality?
Well, so the quality, I feel, is like, it's all, it's a big jump up because the term craft means you can only have so much output, right, per season. And in order to follow in with that, like, yeah, because it's a lot of smaller people doing it, and it's a kind of like a grassroots kind of thing.
Buzzwords.
Like, oh, right.
Microbrew. Yeah. Grassroots. Yeah, small batch. But it's all true.
Yeah.
I'm not going to call it an aspect of it.
No, people, they will tack on so many other buzzwords to it, but like, it's just basically a small operation that starts out because people geek out about beer. Because they find something they really want to do and they really want to make. Like, me as a home brewer, whenever I brew beer myself, I was like, all right, what do I want to make? You know, what do I feel that's different that I can get my hands on in the local area and create the best possible product I can from that? Mm-hmm. And that is what stems out from a lot of these breweries. Because they get so much support in from their hometowns and like their local areas. Like, yeah, you guys are doing great. You're making delicious beer. Everyone wants it.
So, so that's something that's really fascinating, though. When I think about home brewing, you know, like for somebody who's like really novice at it, I'm thinking like you could buy these hops online and then you could make it at home. But like, what's the real process in this whole crafting scene? Like, how do you make beer? That's really interesting, you know? Mm-hmm.
Well, so what I started out, I just went to my local homebrew supply store, which there are out here. And I just got a kit, you know? It came with my hop extract, my malt, my grains, everything else. And all I had to do was follow the instructions. Everything was prepackaged. So you're still following a recipe here. Mm-hmm. And just like anything else, whenever you're cooking and creating, you start with the basics, and then once you gain a better understanding of it, you can deviate from there. Once you learn what works, what doesn't, certain flavor profiles and tastes, you can start to interject your own ideas and creativity with that, right? And so what started out from like all this pre-assembled kits, now it's like, all right, I think this kind of hop varietal will work with this grain bill to create this IPA that I'm going to dry hop at the end rather than the whole way. So it's a big learning experience that you take all these small pieces and you just keep building off of it like anything else.
So typically, I know it depends on the type of beer, but like, how long does it typically take and how many servings do you normally get when you make one?
So the batch recipes that I work with, it's about 5 gallons, right?
Wow.
Five gallons is enough to fill up a sixo, which is 1/6 of a, you know, it's, I guess a full keg size. Or it's 5.56 gallons. Yeah, which is what is in commercial kegs, right? Or if you were to bottle it within 12-ounce bottles, you'll get a yield of, like, what, 50 to 60, I think, 12-ounce bottles.
That's quite a bit.
Yeah. And so whenever you do it, I mean, you'll have beer for a while, and you pray that it's good because you have to drink all of it.
Yeah, but the difference is some of these, like, craft brewers, they're making it at a scale that's, like, enough to serve their city, but
mm-hmm. you know, at the same time, make it consistent enough too, right?
Exactly. Because you have to work what you have, and if they're going to create a beard that they're going to become known for, they have to be able to continue it, which is why certain breweries will only pick like one or two types of beers, or like have one be their flagship. But in order to work with fluctuating, you know, availability of resources, they have to be adaptable as well, which is something I will give credit to, like all these big breweries. The ability to create that much of a consistent product on that large of a scale is very impressive.
Mm. But they've got to detract somewhere down the line for that to make it happen, right? Like,
mm-hmm. And there they detract from, you know, what actually makes up the beer. Because the most popular beers around the world that are, that pop, you know, in demand, I guess. Most people, like, that's in the know. Budweiser, they're lagers, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They're lower ABVs, generally below 5% ABV. And just kind of like, it's cool, it's refreshing, it's easy to drink, right? It's a kind of an intro beer.
I can really, like, think of it as, like, fast food, kind of. Like, you know, the ability for McDonald's to just churn out the same quality of food over and over and over again and serve it to, like, a global audience mm-hmm. is what I think, like, when we think of these macro brew beers, you know?
Yeah.
Whereas, like, some of these, like, craft microbrews is more of, like, a really good restaurant in your town, right? Like, the two... Mm-hmm. don't compare, because like the restaurant in town is obviously going to have, like, you know, maybe locally sourced ingredients or whatever.
Yeah.
It's going to taste like, you know, in terms of taste, it's going to be miles better.
Mm-hmm. Because there's only
to so many people, right? Like, it's hard mm-hmm. for them to scale up, I guess. And I think that's kind of the same with the beer scene as well.
Right. They're working with small scale local ingredients to make the highest quality product they can. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's not going to be sustainable on a large global operation.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. Exactly. Yep. I mean, I would agree that, you know, you can taste the difference, because when I went to Germany and also Spain, I know Germany gets a huge reputation for having great beer. And really, when I was there, I could taste the difference. I mean, there was a clearly different taste. There's clearly different textures. And it's, I don't know how to explain it. But... You know, if you are a beer drinker and you've never had quality beer, you should try it, because it really is a difference. Even if you did a blind test, I could taste it. You know, it was really a difference.
But even then, sometimes too, it's like you're not used to it at first, so maybe you don't know what to think of it, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, when I first had an IPA, I'm like, oh man, this tastes like a cactus. But now I love IPAs, so.
So let me ask you this. If somebody who's used to mass consumer type beers.
Traditional, right?
Yeah,
traditional.
What would be a good... entrance into the whole craft root beers for the majority of people that they would probably want to try first? And I'm not mm-hmm. talking like something hardcore, you know, but
so let's even look at trends right now. Like, ciders are really trendy, right? Because they're really mm-hmm. easy to drink, and it is different from like traditional lager. I think people really have been enjoying that. So I would mm-hmm. I mean, that's what most people kind of like gravitate towards. Like, I would say wheat beers, Hefeweizen, ciders. Mm-hmm. It's really easy, light, and drinkable for, like, I think the traditional beer drinkers, you know, who haven't really stuck
right.
to like the craft scene just yet.
If you're used to a lot of these big macro brews, I mean, like, higher class lagers and pilsners are always going to be easy. Or what I find is funny, a lot of people, they'll gravitate towards Blue Moon, right?
Yeah.
Blue Moon is a Belgian style white ale. However, Blue Moon is owned by Coors.
Mm-hmm.
And so they still fall under that category, because it's like a, you know, an offshoot. But like a Belgian white ale it's still going to be crisp. It's going to be clean. It's going to have a little higher of a carbonation rate, and the Belgian yeast in it will give a little more sweet and spice on the end. One of my favorite picks in that category is the Allagash White. They're based out of Portland, Maine. And they are a fantastic Belgian white ale to really start easing you into some of the nuances in craft beer.
I even like the name of it. The name even sounds good.
mm-hmm. And yeah. They're great. I love those guys. I mean, growing up back in the South, Shiner, man.
Yeah, Shiner. You can't go wrong.
I also drink Shiner.
Shiner Box, Rolling Rock, and every now and then a little Lone Star Light.
Right.
I don't know about that last one.
Yeah. It's a German Bock, you know, which is still like from part of the Lager family and all that. Mm-hmm. However, that is also where I learned Boulevard. They're based out of Missouri, and we still get them out here in California. And those guys are doing fantastic things with beers. Like growing up in that area, we would see them and I was like, oh, what is this? And currently now they're doing a bunch of crazy sours and other like bread items and other great.
And they kind of have the benefit of being able to like traditionally serve to a larger area because they are one of the bigger ones out in the Midwest, right? So the fact that they can both meet this like supply, but at the same time try these different varieties out is pretty crazy, right? Because I guess you wouldn't normally expect that from like a brewery like that big.
Because they have some of their core items which got them where they are now, but they're still innovating and they're still seeing what they can come up with, which is great.
Or it could be, I mean, maybe to a lot of other people it could be considered a risk, right? Because if we change it up now, then we're gonna lose our customer base or we're gonna fail. But the fact that they're trying is really cool. Yeah.
Well, the thing is you actually have to.
And nowadays you have to,
Yeah. So let's take for instance, there's another craft brewery here in San Francisco. Some of you might know as Speakeasy, right? These guys have been around for a while. They're one of the first craft brews that came out. However, they never really did much more to innovate beyond that. And with all the new competition now, they actually just announced that they're going to be closing up.
Crazy. Yeah.
So, which just goes to show, I mean, you can serve your audience like that, but if you don't keep up, you're going to get left in the dust.
So that's really funny how that's relevant to technology, because there are different technologies in the whole beer crafting world. You know, you got to constantly innovate. You got to put in the R&D. So the same
concept. You're too conservative.
Yeah.
It may not pan out for you. Yeah.
And it's just, it applies all across the board. And I'm sad to see them go, but at the same time, they had their shot.
Definitely.
So what are you actually drinking right now?
Right now?
Uh-huh.
I'm drinking this guy here, the Just Outstanding IPA from Kern River, which definitely lives up to its name. It's
So if the brewery has the word river in it, it's probably going to be good.
There's so many in California.
Six rivers, two rivers, Mad River, Russian River.
Yeah, I know. Speaking of Russian River, so this is something that if you're geeking out on beer, you might know as well. Russian River, their beers, people all around the world go crazy for, right? And because they have a few that are world renowned, and there's one that comes out every year to kind of coincide with Beer Week. And that is Pliny the Younger. I'm talking about a beer. This is where people wait 7 hours in line for just to get a taste of.
Wow, that's like an iPhone launch. So
yeah. Probably. I ran into some guys who were talking about like, oh yeah, we're going to drive up there and we're going to camp out at 3 a.m. and stake our own spot. I was like,
it's like Black Friday, like midnight release. No, even past midnight release levels.
Now, that is a whole level of geekness that I don't think most people would understand. You think you love beer, you really don't love beer.
No. There are the fanatics out there, and these guys have always been like the cream of the crop, you know? And it's good. But they've actually met their match this year. They were actually, it's not the first time they've lost too, but so in Hayward during Beer Week, there's the Bistro, which holds a triple IPA contest, which is what Pliny the Younger falls under. And for those of you who don't know, IPAs are kind of divided up into single, double, and triple, where that's kind of dependent on the how much goes into the beer. So a single IPA is generally around 6 to 7%. A double IPA goes from 8 to 10, and anything 10 and over is a triple IPA, right? They're just increasing the amount of hops and malt and everything else.
And so naturally, like, the taste becomes kind of like subsequently like a little bit more and more bitter and more like hardcore IPA taste to it, right?
Mm-hmm. Actually, bitter and sweeter because of the amount of yeast and the sugars that come out from it, become sweeter and maltier, and it's just a big beer, you know? And for once, this beer, it was actually overtaken by another local brewery, Moonraker, in Auburn, California. Their triple IPA Extremis beat out Russian River's Pliny the Younger. And not far behind that was another local brewery, Fieldworks Tundra Triple IPA.
I think maybe if you get a chance at the next one, maybe you want to record some of it, you know, so maybe we could show our audiences who are not familiar with this whole world, this whole geeky world of beers, craft beers. That'd be really interesting, you know. I don't know many people out of all the people I've ever met who really know that particular community. That's really a whole different segment, you know?
Yeah.
And I'll be definitely taking... starting to branch out nationwide, even. You start seeing, like, it become trendier and trendier, more and more cities. And you even start to see, like, traditional or, like, franchise restaurants, things like that, like, I don't know, like, Buffalo Wild Wings, for example, right? Everyone's starting to pick up, like, oh, we have craft beers now, you know? Even though it may not be, like, true craft beers, but they try to add that angle on because they know it is a thing that is up and coming. Yeah. So
it's great marketing, you know. I mean, all the trends come from California first before it becomes nationwide. It's kind of funny.
Yeah, yeah.
Speaking of trends, there you had some food trends with you that I think really is exploding in California, but that'll make it out to the rest of the United States.
So as of lately, there have been a lot of great options for home delivery, because restaurant delivery platforms are huge here right now, right? What started out is, some of you may know, there were services such as Postmates or DoorDash, where you would go on, you create an account with one of these services, and they would be able to pick up and deliver something back to you, right? Most likely it's going to be food. And so what used to be like delivery options that was just regulated to, you know, pizza. Nah. Now you can get whatever you want. And there are so many services that are capitalizing on it right now. So, I mean, I personally work with DoorDash, Eat24, Caviar, Uber Eats, and Postmates through my line of employment. And this is becoming a really big trend in restaurants, because more and more people, they don't always want to go out to get your stuff. Mm-hmm. If they can have it sent to their home because of their time schedules and how busy life is, it just works out that way. And people are taking note of that.
So what is, you had some food a little bit earlier. What do you have like with you that was just...
Oh, yeah. Dude, so me, myself, it's over here. All right. So I've got a little bit of a different take on just regular Chinese takeout, right? There's a really nice Sichuan place by me, and so I got them to deliver some Mapo Tofu, which is delicious. Got a little bit of rice, of course, to go with that, and some twice-cooked pork.
Oh, that looks good. Now I'm curious about something, okay, because... this is not something that's new in California. It's been around for a while now, you know. However, for the rest of the United States, Uber Eats is just barely starting to roll out in multiple states. How is this different from traditional, because you can always order food before, like takeout, Chinese takeout. That's a perfect example. So how is this different?
My guess, and correct me if I'm wrong, but this is my initial take on it. I'm in DC services, but from like an outsider's perspective, I would say that the restaurant itself doesn't have to manage this delivery service, right? This is kind of like a third-party service, right? Yes or no?
It is a third-party service, however...
But they partner up with these people, right?
Yeah, so the cool thing is they'll come out to restaurants and establishments and they'll help them set up an online menu, right? Mm-hmm. So they take all of the pre-existing items on that restaurant's menu and they'll put it up on their app. So they're working on the convenience angle here. Mm-hmm. If you can open up your phone and there's a full menu, that's like, oh yeah, I want this.
But
this,
the burden isn't on the restaurant to set it up, right? They have help from an outside company and they like both benefit from it.
It is mostly coming from the outside company. However, the restaurant does have to deal with whenever they have to, first of all, acknowledge the orders that come in, right? Mm-hmm. So let's say you're on top of a busy lunch period. You still have to physically go over and you'll get a notification from your, because they deliver you iPads or another tablet. And you have to input the order and you have to make sure, all right, everything's still there and they can complete the order.
Mm.
So right. It works out whenever you have a fully functioning force to help out with that.
Right, but what I'm saying is like they don't have to hire people to do specifically deliveries right out of their place.
Oh, no, that's the great part.
That's what I'm saying.
Right? Yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, before they would have to take one of their employees and send them out and take them away from the restaurant. Now people come up and pick it up.
So it's kind of like using like having like the ability to use credit cards at a restaurant, right? Like the restaurant doesn't have to set up their own credit card system. They, you know, they use like an outside party to integrate it into their business. And same thing with these, right?
Yeah.
Take an outside third party service and integrate it into their own business, right? So they don't have to set up like the menu or like the ordering system or the process or the drivers even. They just, all they gotta do is just get integrated, make the food, and complete the orders, right?
Mm-hmm.
As if it was like a traditional, just like a normal, like, you know, order out, right?
Yeah.
Like if someone came into the restaurant.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
And, you know, these type of services, you know, these are really technology-based, you know, if you think about it. And it's happening in almost every industry, you know. There are a lot of places where you could deliver packages for Amazon or for UPS or United States Postal Service. So by companies doing this, not only are they leveraging technology, but they're also leveraging a cheaper workforce. Because for these people who are doing deliveries, they don't have to pay them the same wages. They don't have to give them insurance. They don't have to do any of that. And also their liability is less because they don't have to work for those companies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that is a model that the convenience factor is obviously the biggest thing. But if you look at companies such as Uber, such as Airbnb, such as all these other companies, they are the new companies. They are the new economy where you don't have employees. You don't even have physical locations or even physical properties for the most part. You're leveraging a very cheap and plentiful workforce to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the way it works is these service providers, you get a cut and they get a cut. Mm-hmm. And so you're getting more business, but they are getting, you're getting cheap labor at the same time. So it's,
right.
It's, so
restaurants suffer a certain percentage, like they it's a agreed upon amount, which is fair, you know, but at the same time, that's business they're getting that they wouldn't get otherwise.
Otherwise,
you know?
Wouldn't get.
Yeah.
Right. And then
so,
the customer ends up paying more for that convenience.
Yes.
So, I mean, there is an increase in cash flow somewhere, right? So,
right. There is delivery fees that come up, and some of these platform services have the option for you to tip or not. Like it's with all of these services, tipping is not included. However, it should be. Tip your servers, people.
Yes, tip your.
So
maybe.
What did you pay for that delivery? So how much was the actual meal, and how much did you pay for delivery? Just to get an idea.
Yeah, right. This. I got food for it because like, I'm not going to eat all that right now. That's going to be food for me tomorrow morning as well for my lunch. But I paid $20 for it.
Wow.
For the food and delivery.
Yep.
Food. So how much was it? The food alone.
What was that?
How much is the food alone without delivery costs?
So I actually got a bit of a discount on this one. My delivery was discounted. Normally, Uber Eats has one of the cheaper service charges.
Mm-hmm.
They normally charge $5 for delivery. All right. That's way.
$5. $5 for convenience, essentially.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
And so, yeah. discounting that, it was $20 for the stuff, which is reasonable. But at the same time, like, I tipped them a little too, because
you work in the service industry, so you understand.
I'm very empathetic to that plight.
Yes.
So how does this negatively affect your business, though? Did you have to, you need less employees because you don't need delivery anymore?
Well, we never delivered to begin with, you know?
Mm.
But now we have four different tablets that we have to manage and keep an eye on for outcoming deliveries. So rather than people just coming in to us, like calling us through that way, we're getting more business, but at the same time, we're having to allocate more of our time and resources to like taking care of it. And sometimes that'll work for us whenever we're able to accommodate that. But let's say we're on a night where we're already slammed and we're getting 20 orders on top of that.
Hmm.
And
it's unpredictable, in a sense. It's almost unpredictable for you, right? Because you never know, like, when you're slammed, and then all of a sudden you get a ton of orders out, right, to go.
Yep, and it's like, oh, snap. It's going to take, like, 40 minutes for food to come out at this point.
Yeah.
But overall, you think this model is profitable? I mean, do you think it's worth it? Or
I do, just because more and more people are adapting to this now.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like I was saying earlier, people just don't have the time for it, you know? And convenience is king these days. Like, that's why so many companies are able to charge a premium for convenience, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's also a big trend here.
Also, in terms of, like, I guess it's kind of similar to internet marketing, too. You can also build an audience, right? So mm-hmm. if someone mm-hmm. can purchase your food for the first time through this app, there's a good likelihood they enjoy it, they want to come back, right, and continue to give you more business.
And if they use the service, they have their phone number and their email, so they can market other products or other food to them, you know. So it's pretty ingenious to me. That's
right.
You know, the only downsides that I can think of immediately is the fact that a lot of these services, not just the food, but also in groceries, like Walmart grocery, they have that, and then the new Amazon, what is it?
Amazon Fresh or local?
Yeah, you just walk in and out. So that means you can reduce your workforce. You know, so you're gonna need less and less people there. And so that is the downside. However, it's inevitable. You know, but it seems like California, they're already there. In my opinion.
Oh, you know? Even local grocery stores right here are implementing, like, you know, order online, pick up here. Safeway has the delivery.
It's all about convenience. People, they have enough. They're willing to use their income to save themselves time.
Which is an interesting problem to have, or like interesting situation to have, because at what point is your time worth this much money, right? Mm-hmm. Like, maybe it's come to the point where, like, just the median of, like, income in the U.S. is like, oh yeah, we're able to afford this, like, where it's more cost effective for me to get something ordered out to me so I can use my time making money somewhere else, right?
Yeah, and that, you know, as anybody knows, time is the one commodity, that's the most valuable commodity, no matter what, you know. And now it's at a premium, it really is, you know. And people want more quote-unquote time, and so they will pay for that, you know. You know, I keep thinking about all these delivery services, all these things that are streamlined. What are your thoughts on, like, you know, because, you know, AI, it's not going anywhere. It's going to keep improving, okay? Not only in the software that we have, but what do you think about robots with really advanced AI taking over cooking and stuff? Do you think that's anywhere near reality?
I'm starting to see certain points where it is. There's, like, a noodle shop in China where they have a robot who can create and chop noodles faster than any other person could, you know?
Wow.
And recently I was in Santa Cruz where there was a bar I went to. It was a craft beer bar and they had 30 taps on. However, there were only two people working because it was all self-service.
Wow.
So,
I mean, and one of those fast food restaurants, I forget which one is it. Was it Wendy's or McDonald's? They're starting to introduce, like, self-serve kiosks pretty soon as well, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, McDonald's did that as a direct counter to workers trying to get better wages. And they're like, yep, nope, you're replaceable.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we're starting to see how I mean, this industry, people are going to become expendable, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's at what cost?
All right. But that's one of, like, the first big mainstream examples, I think, like, that everyone's going to see is once it, like, hits fast food or something like that, right?
I mean, fast food is the epitome of efficiency.
Oh, and then eventually trucks, right?
Self-driving trucks, self-driving boats.
The Uber lines that will just, like, carry everything across. And because of that, we'll see, actual ghost towns, because smaller communities that would serve for long-haul truckers, that's going to be phased out.
And, you know, this is something that I don't think it's talked about enough in the mainstream media, but people who are geeks, they know that this is the future. And so for all those people out there who are not yet geeky or not yet a nerd, start learning. Because in the future, there's not going to be a place for many humans. That's just the reality of it.
Robots will take our jobs, right?
Yeah. Well, it's mainly AI. You know, you need the AI to take over humans. And like you were talking about, the convenience factor, the efficiency, it's worth it. You know?
I mean, so, not only AI, but also cost effectiveness, right?
So
when this machinery starts getting, I mean, obviously, like, the only reason why we can have more widespread AI is because the cost of computing is getting cheaper and cheaper.
Exactly.
Right? Where it makes sense to implement, replace people. So, yeah, not only the AI, but not the means to do it and the means to do it at a cheap enough price. Right?
Yeah. And, you know, people, unfortunately, they're the most expensive part of any business. I mean, if you think about all the car factories, okay, they've been doing this for decades now. A lot of people think that jobs are coming back to manufacturing. They're not. If you go to any modern car manufacturing plant, they're all robots. And
they're trying to get more and more efficient. I mean,
efficient. Yeah. I mean, unfortunately, that's people are people, so they're going to be less efficient and they're going to make mistakes. Whereas if you have a machine that has really good AI, and
it's predictable.
It's predictable. It's the rate of failure is going to be way less. Yeah, it's better if you invested in a machine that never has to sleep, doesn't eat, doesn't get sick. The repairs are still going to be less than you would pay for a human for the insurance. Right. Unfortunately, that's where we're headed, you know. And I'm glad you brought up that McDonald's example of the kiosk. Mm-hmm. Because in South Korea and Japan, they've already had this before. Amazon Fresh took that model where you just put your phone up to the QR code, and that's it. You get the food delivered.
Remember that concept of Japan way long ago. People were waiting for the subway, right? They're waiting for the subway. All they got to do is just like,
boop, 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 and
then it would be delivered to them when they got home.
Yep. It's kind of scary, but that's, I mean, scary for people who are not aware that their job is, anyway.
Well, something else that's a little scary about it, too, is they're going to be recording your every movement as soon as you step in through the door.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll track your, like, oh, your purchasing habits, where you like, oh, this looks good, that looks good.
Yeah, and they're tracking
your habits and everything too.
Well, they're tracking that with your smartphone already. So I mean, it's location specific. You know, they just send you ads, and then whenever we have glasses or contacts with screens on them, they just shoot you an ad, augmented reality. You know, it's just
Blade Runner.
Yeah,
reality.
Yeah, hyper reality. Yeah, Blade Runner.
Yeah, that video. Yeah. So it would be very interesting to see if there's like a lot of privacy legislation that would come out of this, right? Cause, like, I was talking with my friends the other day, and I had an idea where, say there's like a camera on top of your menu board, right? And it tracks your eyeball movement to see where your eyeballs kind of deviate towards the menu, just to see what people, you know, kind of like feel like. So, I mean, anyway, like, the point I'm trying to get at is, I mean, at what point, like, what's the legality of that, right? And since we're going to be able to track all more information about us, you know, we kind of have to agree to it, right? Like,
yeah,
I guess it has to be disclosed to us, and then we agree to it.
Yeah.
I think it'd be interesting to see like that kind of legislation kind of come forward.
Yeah.
I mean, for smartphone apps and the internet, there's always like, yes, I agree, continue. No one ever reads it, but what happens to the point where these services or these tracking devices are in a restaurant, right, as soon as you walk into the door? Like, I wonder what's going to be like then.
Like,
there's like a touch screen on the door where you're like, I agree to enter this restaurant, and let them track on this data. I'm like, okay, you know, press it, then you can go inside or something like that.
I don't think people have a choice, because in other countries, like in a part of England, they have more surveillance cameras than any other place in any metropolitan area. So they're going to find ways to do it. And saying, a lot of these services, you can't use it without agreeing. And so unless you want to live in a cave, and even then they could track you, it's almost inevitable, you know.
Right,
it's
right.
Unfortunately.
I mean, but the security cameras in England is more of like a security measure, right? Like through their laws and stuff, it's like, oh yeah, we need to make sure that, you know, from a security standpoint, from what they say, security standpoint.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
From what they say, yes.
But this is kind of like a different set of data, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's kind of like more in depth and more like personal about you, you know. So I'm wondering like how that's gonna fall into it, because I mean, it's not for safety reasons; it's for getting information to sell you more stuff reasons.
Well, do y'all remember that movie Gattaca? Do y'all remember that movie Gattaca?
Mm-hmm.
Where they had like a genome, what is it, racism? Genome racism? Where if you don't have the correct DNA, it had Ethan Hawke. You know, so whenever you went to work, it would prick you and it would test your blood. And if you weren't part of a certain DNA, then you were considered a lower class. So I'm sorry, that's not as relevant, but do you remember that episode in Black Mirror where you your class was based upon how many likes you got? Did you see that episode?
Yes. Yeah, it was with the girl, right?
Yes. Yes. Anyway, I'm getting off tangent, but that's technology. Oh man, it's kind of crazy. Oh. But
yeah, so I sent you a link for a documentary. It's called Hypernormalization, and I think I could see, I don't know what when it came out, but Black Mirror, kind of like, this is like the real life version of Black Mirror through this documentary. And it's crazy. I'm like, I get that same feeling of like despair and like not being able to do anything about it. But the difference is like we're actually living it. And like,
that's why I like Black Mirror so much, because it's
watch
really
the documentary. I think you'll enjoy it. I tuned in at like, I think the hour 30 minute mark, but I couldn't stop watching it from there. So
it's scary because it's becoming fact and fiction is getting a lot closer.
Yeah, and you have a different perspective because you're actually in it. You know, you're actually in the whole business of using this technology to where you could actually see the real world effects of it, you know?
Yeah. Not only the technology, but because like that documentary, and I don't want to get into politics on the show, but it does deal with a lot of like the modern politics. And I want to say it's from an objective, like a more objective standpoint. I mean, I can't be the one to say that. I mean, if you guys watch it, then you can determine that. But
what is the name of that documentary? Do you know offhand?
Normalization. It's the idea that in politics, there's so many lies, and it's just like this theater of confusion that we don't know what to believe is true or not. Mm-hmm. And so we can't do anything about it, so we just accept it. So it's called hyper-normalization. It's like the term.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
And it is on YouTube, by the way. It's about two hours
it's
long.
It's free on YouTube. From what I've watched, it's a fantastic documentary. If you're trying to get like a, maybe if you haven't been following politics that much, but you kind of want like a current grasp on it from a, I want to say more objective standpoint, because it kind of goes over like what everyone has done wrong. You know, it doesn't try to like put into light only like one political party or anything. It's like, well, we did this wrong. We did this wrong. This is why this did this, this, and this, this. And it goes all the way back to the mid 70s.
Wow.
Right. So
I'm going to watch it. So maybe we'll have something else to talk about as well in our next episode. That sounds so interesting.
Yeah, I've enjoyed it so far, but at the same time, it is like, it is what Black Mirror would be based off of, to be honest. Mm-hmm. It's the same vibes, definitely. But the difference is like, when you're living in it, and when you, like, we kind of, I would say we kind of ignore politics for the most part, right? So we don't really get into it, so we don't see it. But when you watch this documentary, it kind of puts everything into perspective, and you're like, whoa, you know, like,
it's like, oh, other people are taking a look at
this happening, and I live in this world, and like, yeah, I live in that world, and it's just
we're all a cog in a machine controlled by others, you know. So unfortunately,
such it is.
That's what it is. It's like knowing like that you're cognizant of the fact, but you keep playing along with it because what else can you do about it? That
exactly.
is hyper normal. That is
break the
that
wheel.
Is
cool.
Anyways, check that out. I've enjoyed it so far, and I'm not normally the one to like dive into like the political side of things, but it is a super interesting documentary, I would say.
Okay.
It is long though, 2.5 hours, so be warned.
Well, this episode is 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
It's all good.
We're getting to that point, yeah.
Yep. So, yeah, I mean, with the addition of our third member, as you can see, we have a ton to talk about, and we didn't really have a schedule. I mean, we just started talking and talking, and it's, I guess, kind of been a rant.
That's a lot of things.
Brotherly.
Yeah, so normally we like to
you know, have our like our topics outlined, and we hit point one, point two, point three, but it's all right. So with that being said, it has been 2.5 hours, and that is a long time. So if you've made it this far, thank you for sticking with us. We're thank glad you. That you found this not only informational, but entertaining.
Yeah.
Entertaining and purposeful.
Thank you for tuning in and listening to us geek out.
Well, yeah, before we go, I did want to talk about something really briefly. Sure. I wanted to talk about YouTube Live. Okay, I did my first live streamings this past week. Right. And, you know, wanted to know what your thoughts are, because one of the things that I really love doing is like this with my brothers, okay? And we're going to be doing more live events. And so whatever you're watching now, this would be very similar format, because we do want to talk to you, the geek community, you know, and to have you involved with our conversations. And you've seen some of these live events. I've seen some live events go for 5 or 6 hours. You know, I don't know, you know, it could get that far, but you know, we'd like to know your thoughts, because, you know, as you know, YouTube is making a big push in live, but then again, Facebook is there, Periscope, live is where it's at. But not only that, but I think it really gives an opportunity for us to actually connect with you. And so, you know, if you had any thoughts and ideas, and like I said, the format is very similar to this. So when you're watching this, this is kind of what would happen if you are watching us live. And so look forward to that, but we'd really like to know some of your thoughts as well.
Just let us know. Hit us up.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, yeah. You know, thank you for our newest member in addition to the show. So
D-Box!
D-Box, D-Box, Danny Box Cutter.
That's the one.
Yeah, Danny Box Cutter. I'm your host, Possibilities. And this is my other co-host, the OG.
C64.
Oh, yeah, watch out with the gangs. I mean, the hands.
Yeah, it's a Commodore 64 game. Yeah. Amiga lovers. Okay.
Yeah, don't throw up the wrong side.
Just bring up the floppy.
Yeah.
we need a strong bad like printer paper.
I know
this. Yeah. Anyways, thank you guys for sticking with us this long, and we hope to bring you a lot of more great content in the future. If there's any games you want us to play, or that you want to recommend us, any movies, TV shows, what have you, let us know.
All right.
We've got plenty of other stuff to geek out about, so whatever you want to hear.
Yeah.
In the meantime, I'm gonna go eat my food.
Okay.
I'm gonna go geek out on something. I'll let you guys know that next week. So yeah.
Okay. Next week.